Forward. As Marilu Henner tells us in this book, memories can indeed be unforgettable. Perhaps not in every way, but in highly interesting and important ways. Most of us can try to remember the many details of experiences long past, and we do, in fact, remember some of them, sometimes. But mostly, we forget. Marilu is different. Most of her long past experiences are highly preserved and readily recalled. She is one of a dozen or so individuals who have been identified as having highly superior autobiographical memory, HSAM. Those of us who study her memory and the memories of the few others we have identified as having highly superior autobiographical memory strongly believe that understanding the brain processes that enable such extraordinary memory may provide new insights into how our brains create and maintain memories, including ordinary ones. Memory is, of course, our most important personal capacity. Insights into the nature of highly superior autobiographical memory could ultimately have critical implications for understanding why most of us mostly forget, and additionally may provide suggestions for dealing with disorders that compromise memory. This book is like no other book about memory, and the insights offered are unique. In these pages, we learn from Marilu what it is like to have such a memory, why it is important to her, and why she thinks we can all benefit by taking steps to improve our own remembering. Readers will learn that Marilu is as well organized as she is thoughtful, insightful, enthusiastic, and, well, delightfully humorous. The advice she offers may not turn all of us, or any of us, into highly superior autobiographical memory-ers, but every reader will learn much about the importance of memory, as well as the things we might do to help us maintain memories of our own personal experiences. Enjoy reading Marilu's Memory Journey. Dr. James L. McGaw, Research Professor, Department of Neurobiology and Behavior, Fellow, Center for the Neurobiology of Learning and Memory, University of California, Irvine.
Preface. One time, I was riding on a train from New York City to Philadelphia with Marilu. This was a long time ago. We were just kids, teenagers nearly, riding together on the Amtrak to Philly, making up our lives as we clicked along. So the conversation dwindled, as conversations often do between young people, and there were periods of awkward silence as the landscape flew by. Marilu was gazing out the window and suddenly remarked, "Hey, is that a junkyard?" I looked out as we flashed past what was definitely a junkyard. I mean, it was this huge field surrounded by a metal fence and filled with junk. It could have been nothing other than a junkyard. That was evident. I looked back at her nervously. "Yeah, I think it's a junkyard." Then we both looked at each other for a few seconds and started laughing, really laughing. It was the kind of laughter that indicated that you were in a friendship, a solid friendship that would last longer than the train ride. An icebreaker laugh. A memorable laugh. And the friendship did last, for decades and decades. Years later, through all the tumult of growing up and growing older, I vaguely remembered that moment on the train to Philly, and I mentioned it once to Marilu to see if she remembered it. Of course, by this time, I was aware of how precise her memory could be. It was sort of a running joke among all the people who knew her that she would remember everything. Yet this moment had occurred decades before. A silly, awkward glitch in a forgotten conversation on a train ride whose purpose was lost to time, or so I thought. But no, Marilu not only remembered the question, the laugh, the awkward realization that we were just bumbling kids on a train. She remembered everything about that day, that train ride, where we were going, who we would meet in Philly. She remembered the weather, the number of the train, the car and seat we were sitting in. She even remembered the specific junk in the junkyard. She remembered the quizzical look on my face when I said, "Yeah, I think it's a junkyard." She remembered how long we laughed and what we said later. She remembered everything, as though the moment had been filmed and she was running the scene in her mind. It was like those videos you take of your children. You watch the film years later and all the feelings and events come back in a rush. Except, for Mary Lou, there's no need for the video. It's all there. Even the delicate emotional overlay, the awkward pause, and the release of laughter. And she can remember the day before that, and the day after, and all the days that followed. James Canning.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Total Memory Makeover. Uncover your past, take charge of your future. By Marilu Henner. Read by the author.
Insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Albert Einstein. That's not insanity, it's bad memory. Marilu Henner. Introduction. Memory is everything. In every single moment of your life, past, present, and future, memory is involved. All that you do, all that you see, everything you learn, each person you meet, and all your experiences have conscious meaning only insofar as you remember them. No matter how much you discover and experience today, its value vanishes if it's forgotten tomorrow. When we're young, we take memory for granted. As we get older, we genuinely fear losing it, not only because the ability itself can fade with age, but also because we are finally wise enough to know its true value. There is no human endeavor more worthy of our best efforts than the pursuit of a great memory. Like it or not, your past is in you, even if you don't remember it. Every single thing you have ever experienced is in you, stored somewhere on your mental hard drive. It's all been recorded in your body and on your psyche, and it is making you behave in ways that you aren't even aware of. This can often scare people, but I think it makes an excellent case for developing one's memory. You may not be consciously connecting this past information to what you are doing in the present, but you should be. You are constantly responding to now because of back then. When you are cognizant of your memories and can call upon them as needed, it keeps you from making the same mistakes over and over again and helps you avoid that pitfall Einstein called insanity. It also makes you better at sizing up situations and making the right choices, as well as understanding why you are the way you are. There are different kinds of memory, but I'm known for my autobiographical memory. Choose any random date during my lifetime, every day since I was 12 in 1964, and I can tell you what day of the week it was and exactly what I was doing on that day. This ability is called Highly Superior Autobiographical Memory, HSAM for short, and I am one of only 12 documented cases in the world so far. I can't tell you what combination of nature and nurture gives someone a superior autobiographical memory, but I can tell you that I have learned and retained my most important life lessons from having one. But this book is not just about my memory or the feats I can accomplish with it. It is much more about what this ability has taught me, and how you can use these lessons to transform your memory, your past, and ultimately your future. It doesn't matter whether or not you were born with my ability. Everyone can remember a great deal more than they do now, and everyone can benefit in the same way I do. All that is needed are the right tools, along with the motivation and effort required to use them. How much would your life change if, from this moment on, you had the ability to always make the right decision in everything you did? It goes without saying that your life, well, anyone's life would improve instantly and dramatically. For example, think of Bill Murray's character, Phil Connors, in the film Groundhog Day. The movie's premise is that Phil must relive the same day over and over again. Eventually, after many repetitions, Phil examines his selfish life and finally finds the wisest choices, best responses, and most helpful actions for every single moment within that one isolated day. And in less than 24 hours, well, 24 hours for everyone else, that is, he becomes the most respected and beloved man in town, gets the girl of his dreams, learns what matters most in life, and sets a course to live happily ever after. Obviously, this is just fun Hollywood fantasy. I'm nobody in the real world bats a thousand. But of course, that is what we aim to do. Groundhog Day was such a success because we would all love to make perfect choices 100% of the time. We all would love to have the information necessary to make the right decision in every moment of every day. I think audiences were delighted to see a character who was given the opportunity to learn from his mistakes, despite the fact that it took him repeated chances to finally get it right. We tend to think of the right decision as what will ultimately get us what we want, whether it's working late for the boss, helping a friend move, hosting a dinner party, investing in a 401k, or even destructive choices like binge drinking or cheating on a loved one. Sometimes the payoff is immediate, and other times the rewards are delayed. But every choice is based on some kind of incentive. Even obviously wrong choices are made with compelling motivations. Ordering a mud pie for dessert is a choice we make because the momentary happiness we expect to receive outweighs in our minds the consequences of those butt-plumping calories. Even if we've made this mistake before, we still might not stop ourselves. It could make us sick, depressed, or unmotivated, but what is most important is that immediate gratification. Forgetting what may result from a choice is never good. For example, because of the debilitating mud pie, we might end up so tired that we skip the 2-mile walk we promised ourselves in the morning. If we could actually see into the future, our choices would be easy. If we knew for a fact that this mud pie would turn out to be the world's greatest dessert experience and would inspire us to upgrade our 2-mile walk to a 5-mile run, the choice to indulge would be perfectly advisable. If we knew that changing careers would eventually lead to a much happier, rewarding life, then that choice would be obvious. But we never really know what will happen. That new career could become overly stressful, disappointing, or obsolete. As you can see, our happiness depends upon predicting, as accurately as possible, what will happen in the future. In order to minimize this risk, we gather information, much like Phil Connors does in Groundhog Day. But we don't have the luxury of do-overs. For us, the past serves as the primary source of this information. The better you remember your own experiences, the faster you will get it, as Phil eventually did. You could say that everything we do in life is like navigating a maze to get to the reward. Success depends on how well we know the course, where all the dead ends are, as well as all the paths that lead to success. It's easy to repeat negative behavior when we don't clearly remember the consequences of that behavior. People often say, "Oh, I'll never drink that much again," only to find themselves doing exactly that. They allow the memory of their hangover to fade. When they are given the choice to take that extra drink, they do it, because they can no longer vividly remember how they felt or the promises they made to themselves. And it's not just because alcohol dulls memory. People have the same mental block when it comes to food, work, consumer credit, exercise, and bad relationships. It takes some people a lifetime to finally accept the connection between self-indulgence and consequence. And some people never realize it. They never really grow up. Remembering your past in a meaningful way is synonymous with growing up. In having HSAM, I have an immense, easily accessible internal library of my past that I can pull from at any time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.